So I was out here a few months ago when they shut the lakefront path for this whole 18-mile stretch that goes along Chicago.
This is a little unnerving. I know a lot of people have worse problems than this, far worse. But I just got informed by a police officer that they're shutting down the lakefront path in Chicago.
They're slowly reopening it. The beaches are not officially open, but the path is, so it's kind of cool to be out here again. So something had me thinking about emotional intelligence and leadership. It's fascinating to, you know, hear these stories of people who are really jerks, yet went on to do amazing things or were amazing leaders. I think Steve Jobs is probably the most famous example of someone like that. And there are plenty of artists, composers who, and I've known some, who were just really mean people. Yet they still had, I would argue, some semblance of an emotional intelligence. Even though they might have been jerks, they were still able to discern the world as separate from just seeing it through their own personal id, if you know what I mean. But I guess what has me thinking about emotional intelligence today is, you know, what happens when you get someone as the leader of your country and arguably the free world who has maybe zero emotional intelligence and is probably a psychopath, a narcissistic lunatic. And I hate to get political, but, and I haven't done many of these stand-up little vlogs during the lockdown because I honestly don't know what to say. I don't know how to respond, and especially with the racial dynamic, you know, who needs to hear from a middle-aged white guy at this time? You know, but when I see what's going on around us now and I see the response of our leadership and the people around him that protect him and how they are destroying, you know, these institutions that in a time like this, we really need them. It's really disheartening to see. And I'm fearful right now because I don't think anyone has really wrapped their heads around the depths of both the health crisis, you know, I think by now we thought we'd be kind of coming out of it, and surely a lot of countries and areas are, but here in the States, at least as of whatever today is, June 25th or something, you know, we're starting to creep back up. And I think a lot of that can be laid at the feet of our leadership, who is not sending a clear signal like, hey, you've got to wear your damn mask. You've got to keep social isolating from people. Just because we're starting to slowly open up doesn't mean the danger's passed. So it's really a bummer to see that lack of leadership and to see them taking advantage of it, actually, and dividing us even more, taking advantage instead of leading us with the racial strife that's going on and trying to provide some healing unity, using that to divide us more. And that just chaps my hide, so to speak. Back to my little self-centered vlog here and why I've kept quiet. And I was kind of inspired to do this one. You know, part of the trick is as a creative during this time is how you do stay focused and keep your sanity. And I suppose I do it just like I've always done it, which is trying to stick to a routine, doing the work, exercising every day, eating tasty, healthy food, it's been nice to spend more time with my family, and I am lucky to have a great group of friends as well. So that's all helped me maintain a lot of focus and sanity through this. Work-wise, it's been odd because things have slowed, but I do have some projects still ongoing, which is great, and I have some projects lined up for the summer, so I'm not worried about that as much, but I've taken the spare time to kind of get my modular tuned up and situated how I want to use it moving forward, which I've really enjoyed. But at the same time, there's something about it that feels so meaningless and self-centered to pursue that purely creative side of things and to invest money and time in such a thing. But I know that at times like this, it's even more important and more valuable, I think, for all of us to really pour ourselves into our craft and into our creativity. I guess that's my response to the craziness, is to try to really hold fast to continuing to push myself in what I do and where I want to take my own and compositional undertakings. So in keeping with the idea of emotional intelligence, when I saw the film 1917, I was really struck by the score that Thomas Newman did for it. As always, he's so elegant and so efficient with his use of music, and how it strikes such a precise emotional tone, and always seems to use the fewest elements to do so. And I made a note then I wanted to pull up some of the cues and dig into them a little bit and maybe do a mock-up. And on YouTube a few days ago, I had re-seen this interview, or kind of a panel interview discussion he did at Oxford and at those symposiums they have. So I watched the rest of it that I hadn't watched, and I was really struck by what a sensitive, kind, empathetic individual he appeared to be. I don't know how he treats the people in his life. I don't know him, but he just really came off as such a humble, highly emotionally intelligent guy. And especially the way he talked about his own ego and as a composer, and how you view the music and yourself, you know, not to put yourself kind of in as a stand-in for the music, but to let the music speak for itself and not to take things so personally or to invest yourself in that way. And I found it really fascinating. Inspired me to then dig up his music and spend some time with it. So I did a little mock-up yesterday of a couple cues, and when I do that, I just load his track into a session and just start to break it apart and figure out the structure. And then if I have the time, go ahead and mock it up, which is what I did in this case. And you always learn a ton by doing it. There was one cue in particular, I can't remember the name of the cue, but it's the fifth track on the soundtrack album. And I love that piece of music. I think mainly, partly because it has this beautiful use of a cello arpeggio throughout the piece. And I've just always loved, that's been one of my favorite elements within music, is using arpeggios, as you probably have all gathered by now. And there's something about how you can express harmonic movement and melodic, and imply melodics at the same time within a single arpeggio. So I remember when I was a kid, I learned Chopin's Etude in C minor. And that has a crazy left hand. It's really a study for your left hand, but the left hand is doing all these crazy arpeggios through the whole piece. And that has a lot of the same techniques being used there, where he's using minor seconds and creating these rubs. So you might have a C minor, and he's using the ninth to go between the D and the E flat. And so you create all this really cool tension. And this particular cue of Thomas Newman's kind of uses a similar technique, but in this case, more of a major sound. Say he's in D, and he's using a rub between the raised fifth, the A and A sharp, and then he'll go to a B flat chord. So similar thing, and I really love that technique. Another great thing about this cue is there are not a lot of different chords used. It's a very small set of chords that repeat, but they always are repeating in different ways. And the arpeggio is always kind of doing variations of itself and iterating on itself. So it always sounds familiar, but it always kind of keeps your ear perked up and moving along. It's just a masterclass in economy, and it's really brilliant.
Let's go ahead and just walk through this. I'm gonna have to put on my headphones here. I'll just kind of show you how I go about, you know, analyzing a track, deconstructing it, and building it back up. And let's see, I'm a little concerned about the copyright issues and having this pulled down, so I'm not going to play too much of the original track. I'm afraid they'll pull it down with mine as well, but we'll see what happens. What I do is I've shown you this in the past. I use this marker lane, and when I'm scoring something, usually I go through, the first thing I do is kind of establish what my tempo is going to be, start to get a lay of the land in terms of things that I want to hit, sections that are going on in the film, and I'll put those in as markers. And then I will take those and I'll convert the marker lane up to the arrangement lane, so I can free up my marker lane then to go in and do what I've done here, which you see, which are the harmonic key changes. So then I have, in the arrangement lane, I've got all my hit points and what's happening visually and things I need to look out for. And then in the marker is what's happening musically. So here you're just seeing the musical things. So I went through, this is the recording from the movie or from the soundtrack here. And I just went through and figured out what the tempo was. There seem to be a little variations in the tempo, so you can see some of my tempo changes here. And I just went through with the Rhodes sound, which is usually what I use, and figured out what the structure of the piece was, the harmonic things that are happening. And, you know, it's surprisingly, like I was saying, it's surprisingly simple, and there's pretty compact set of chords happening, and it stays in a one tonal center, but it's just really effective how he's, especially the changes in the harmonic, you know, like going from the chord of a D to a B flat, and those sort of half step changes that he likes to do that are happening at really critical moments, or going from a major to a minor, really uses those effectively. There's a lot of that sort of modal shifting going on here. So the lay, this is the, you're seeing in the markers, the lay of the land, harmonically. And then I started, since this one is so dependent on that, cello arpeggio that's happening, that was kind of the first, after sketching out the intro celeste parts. The top one's a little crazy, isn't it? And you know, this got surprisingly close to the sound that they had from the actual recording, but it wasn't like I set out to do an exact replica of the sound. So it's, you know, it's close, but that was not my aim in this. My aim was to really get into the parts and study what was going on musically. And everything else was just kind of for fun. So once I did the celeste, then I dove into the cello part. And, you know, I just kind of would listen to a few bars, figure it out, play it in, listen back and forth, and just kind of go through section by bar by bar, section by section. And someone was asking me how this must have taken you hours and hours. And I think all told, I spent about a day on it. I started in the evening 2 days ago, did a little bit, and then I probably spent about 6 hours on it yesterday. Once you get into it, you know, it doesn't take that long to do. Let's see, something is soloed. So the cello and all the strings are from the Spitfire chamber strings, seem to match sonically what was happening with his the closest. Yeah, so just get in and start playing it. A lot of expression is kind of the overall volume. And then the modulation is the more which samples are being played, how intense the actual samples are. Getting some glitching there. And then you get into the arpeggio stuff. This is the, So after that, I focused on the viola part, and the viola seems to start out doing more of the, they both start out doing more of the sustained parts. The cello begins to do some of the arpeggiation, and the viola continues on with the sustain. Not hearing it now, but come in here. And then looks to be about halfway through, a little more than halfway through the piece, the viola joins in and starts doubling the cello, as far as I could tell. And actually, that's a moment, that's kind of a critical moment in the whole piece, because up till that time, the violas and all of the violins were playing all the sustained parts on top, and then they all join in and start playing this arpeggiated line briefly, and it's a real nice change that happens, and happens twice there. And then the strings kind of go back to what they were doing. So I did the viola. And then I did the violin 1 and 2. And again, those are also chamber strings, and they're just being sent to a little Valhalla reverb. And I tend to use, on most of these orchestral instruments, I'll use one of these Plug-in Alliance channel strips, either the Focusrite or the one that is a emulation of an old Neve, to both boost the gain, and typically, I'm not here, but typically I will add a little bite or a little sizzle, like I'm doing with the cello here, on the higher end of the EQ. And that, to me, it just gives it a little more sizzle, a little more harmonic distortion, just subtly, which I think is built into these EQs, these old emulations. So that really helps bring it to life for me. And then I'm giving it a little gain here. So that's on most of the orchestral stuff. I think I mainly use the Focusrite one, which I love. Figured out his viola, a violin 1 and 2 parts. And they start out, let's look at them together. Yeah, so they start out in unison. As I could tell, as far as I could figure out. I think that's even in unison with the viola. And then they spread into a chord here. Just going up in thirds. The sixth. So, and this is, harmonically, this is part of the trick that's going on through this whole thing is... the minor second movement back and forth. So in this case, it's over a D chord, and he's raising the fifth, kind of up and down. So and you're hearing that especially in the violins, which are doing the third up between the F sharp and the A sharp, and then when it goes back to regular D chord, that top A sharp drops down to an A. So That's a real effective movement that's happening throughout the piece. I'm not sure why we're getting that glitching. Let's try that again. So this is an example of the violins playing that third with the raised fifth and then dropping to the regular D. So you hear that raised fifth on top. And the cello arpeggiation line is really playing up that interval as well, that between the A and the B flat or A sharp. So I really love that. And you see it all over the cello part where it's going between the A, you know, these, that movement. And then when he goes to the B flat, I think he also plays around with, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, between the E and the F, which is kind of that's why I have, whenever there's a B flat, I mark it as Lydian, because he's kind of in that Lydian sound where you've got the raised fourth, and that's the E flat to the F over the B flat. So that sounds like this. So it's a similar sound. Yeah, so that's what's happening in the violins. And then, like I said, they all go together and start playing this line. So that's all the strings together, except for the bass. Cello's a little crazy there on that. What's happening there? Well, let's mellow that out a little bit. So this cello line seems kind of... Why don't we just do this to it? It's probably not the only way to do it, but... There we go. And then after the violins, we went to took a look at the bass. And it's really doing more long sub type activity. It's got some nice growl. You can hear it on there. And then that gets doubled with a sub sine wave. And I typically use, I'm just very comfortable in Serum, so I usually just pull that up. And just use a sine wave. That's all that's happening there for the sub. And that really gives it that, the bum rumbler. And that's just doubling the, you probably need really good headphones or nice speakers to hear that. It's down there, but it adds a lot. And it's doubling the bass the whole way, I think. The bass strings. All right. And then there's kind of a, maybe I'll play a little bit of it. He has kind of a choir pad. So there are a lot of atmospherics in his that I didn't get into mimicking, but he does have this vocal sound, synth sound that was pretty prominent. So nope. There you hear it. And it's going between the C and the D there. So that's kind of a little bit of a rub that happens. So I did that just quickly and just with the pad sound from Omnisphere. Put it in, threw a little decapitator just to grunge it up a little bit. and Valhalla again. And that comes in, and then that kind of keeps going through most of the piece. Yeah, there's a moment there where there's a nice rub. Let's listen to that in the original. So you'll hear this rub in the voices. Right now. So in ours, that's... Yeah, so it's between the root note and then it just goes up a half step. All right, so that's the pad. And then we get into the brasses, which come in. I've gone over this in the past, how I like to do things. It seems like in terms of doing stems and with the groups and everything, I've been using stacks for all the sections. So all the strings are in this track stack for strings. And then when I go to mix things, I tend to do mastering on that stem, so right on this the summing track that all the strings are going through, that's where I'll add any EQ or any subtle compression I want to do, which is not much really for something like this, but if I were going to do that, I would do it there, so that when you lay your stems off, you know, they put it all together and it's going to sound proper, as opposed to what I've done in this case, where I've put all my, I did some mastering stuff, but I did it on the full mix later. So I wouldn't do that if I were going to be generating stems. I would do it right on these summing tracks, which is kind of handy. And then you can, I've already got it pre-set up here with the sends to some audio tracks that are hidden right now. So when you go to lay off the stems, you just set all those audio tracks in record and lay them down at one time. So that's how I have things organized. So let's look at the brass. And I think there are some things happening in his track down in the lower sections where it's filled out a little bit more, which I couldn't quite hear. But I think I got the main gist of what was happening. And the brass parts are pretty straightforward. So they first come in. Let's play this first. So through here, I think you hear some sustained brass in there. So here's mine. So I started to bring them. Just. So this is just the horn. Dynamics really important on the brass, because these are Spitfire symphonic brass in this case. The dynamics are such that when you're down in this lower dynamic region, you can get that warm sound, but it quickly gets into that blatty. So that's what you're really playing with to get it when you want it to speak and get that blat. So that's what's happening with this modulation layer. So you can see at the end of this phrase, things really get so they're tucked underneath here. And then they really speak out. And then the bones are really just doing more of the anchoring of the low section. So together, that section. So for those kind of swells, thank you. that's a really critical moment there, where the horns are doubling what's happening in the strings, the line that's going on there. That's not really all. Yeah. So that's compositionally, that's a really cool moment, because all the strings have just gone to playing the arpeggios together, which is a nice change. And then after that, you've got the horns suddenly stepping out and doubling some of that melody. So that's a really... strings all together, and then the horn steps in. So, really brilliant. Nice move. So, and then the last thing, which I kind of hacked in there as well, are some of the low drums. So there's just a bass drum happening on some of the big swells, and then a timpani comes in, and he has some other things as well, like some cymbals and stuff, but I just did a gong on the some of those big swell moments, and that's it. So for mastering, I used Ozone first, and I loaded in his track as a reference. Where do you do that? So here you can load in a reference track. So I loaded in their track, and the mastering system on Ozone is pretty brilliant, and it will suggest some things to get you in the zone of sounding sonically like your reference track. So it looks like it did some dipping there, which is not surprising, but that was about all it had to do. And then I did a little additional just to smudge it up a bit, because I like to use this. I like to use the Vertigo to do some mid-side harmonic distortion, which you hear there. And then some of the mid is just doing, I think, the mid-range. So that's just adding, it sounds like crap, but it's adding a little body. So when you mix that in, just widens it. Very subtle compression with the compressor. Not even really moving it much. Yeah, very subtle. Quite a lot of, quite a lot of the Moog EQ, adding the famous air and trying to, it's funny, maybe this EQ over here took too much body out because I felt like I wanted to add some in. Or is that, that's actually doing upward, but anyways. So I wanted to add a little body back in, warmed it up, but then added some air, and just very subtle limiting. I don't think it should be limiting that much at all. Yeah, barely touching that. So sonically, so you can hear, let's go to like the section where the... So let's go to his track. So that's the recording. Here's mine. His. It's a little softer. So it's pretty close. So maybe just for shits and giggles, I'll play the whole thing down, and then that'll be it. So hopefully this was interesting or educational for you. It sure was for me. I really enjoyed breaking it down. I did another cue before doing this one, the number 3 Gehenna. I don't know how you say that. But yeah, this one is number 5 on the soundtrack album, The Night Window. So let's play it down, and I'll just kind of... Oh yeah, it starts with ice strings from one of the Albion libraries, Albion 4. Yeah, so you, at the end, as things are kind of going down, it's got that cello line playing up the minor second interval again. Between the B flat and the A, which is kind of cool. And I like some of the other thing which I love is some of the counterpoint or the harmonic things going on with the echoing and the violins, which I think that's here. Right here. They kind of step out and do their own thing there. But yeah, it was a lot of fun to do that, and I hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you next time.